Hi, I'm Lisa Dunn, Head of Special Collections and Archives at the Colorado School of Mines Library. And I am going to give a presentation on Colorado Mining History in Images, Accessibility, and Preservation for the Long Haul. This is a presentation that I gave at the Mining History Association meeting in Birmingham, Alabama in 2022. I'm going to talk about how we, all of us, can make mining images accessible for the long haul and how we can support access and preservation in partnership for this goal, because this is definitely a partnership. I'll be using examples from two collections in our Mining History Archive. I'll describe image management and best practices at our site and describe why these best practices matter to users, donors, and archives. The Russell L. and Linwood Mining History Archive is focused on mining and related technologies. It has international content, but its focus is on the U.S. West. Most of our materials comprise a physical archive, but several years ago, we also began emphasizing our digital archives because of the benefits of accessibility for our users. The two collections I'm using here as examples are the Colorado Mining Association collection. The association was established in 1876 as part of its operations. It's chronicled the history of mining in Colorado through photographs. The association donated its photo archives of about 600 images from the 1890s to the 1990s to our archive. The Gilman, New Jersey Zinc Company collection images were donated by the Friends of Mineralogy Colorado chapter. The collection of about 175 images, 1880s to 1949, focuses on mining in Gilman and its surrounding areas and Eagle County in Colorado. These are physical photographs that we've digitized. You'll see examples from these collections throughout this presentation. So, digital image management, from our archives perspective, our main concerns are accessibility, discoverability, and preservation. Our ultimate goal is to have an impact, to reach our users with content and make this content of use to them. So, just to give you an example, in the past 6 months, the two collections I've just mentioned together gathered over 34,000 visits. And this isn't just from the U.S., these were internationally, just across the globe, people viewing the photographs from these collections. So I'm going to break this down, digital image management best practices, into accessibility, discoverability, and preservation. So for accessibility, what it boils down to is, can you actually see the image? Can you get to the image and view it? Our content is open access, so there's no fee for access, no barriers. Reducing barriers to web-based content is important. We know that most people cannot travel to our archive in Golden, Colorado to view our photographs. So we strive to comply with Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, WCAG, best practices, which emphasize straightforward web pages that support assistive technologies. A big component of accessibility, though, is intellectual property management, which impacts what we make accessible and how. From the donor side, as creator and owner of these images, the donor signs a gift agreement that gives us non-exclusive, perpetual, royalty-free rights to reproduce, retain, modify, and distribute. This is not the same as copyright. The creator or owner still holds whatever copyright they had before. From the archive side, our current practice is to apply a Creative Commons license that allows the user to copy, transform, and distribute the work for non-commercial purposes. We're broadening access this way. It supports creativity, reuse, and sharing by our audience. Best practice in discoverability. We address this by creating descriptive information, otherwise known as metadata. The simplest definition is data about data. If the image is the data, the metadata is the information about the image, including both the physical format and what the image depicts. Metadata is really a big thing for archivists and librarians. We think about it a lot. Our metadata has internationally standardized rules, somewhat like computer coding, and that is how it functions. So here's an example of an image from the Colorado Mining Association collection, accompanied by just some of the metadata we created for this image. This can include doing some research as well, especially if there are no captions or accompanying information with an image. In my time, I've created timelines for mining districts. I've tracked down company histories and biographies, And I've even hunted down automobile styles to get a date range from cars parked on the street in the image itself. So what does metadata get us? Why is it so important and why do we spend so much time on it? First of all, it provides context aimed at a wider audience that may be unfamiliar with what they're seeing. It also drives discovery. It allows you to search for and find images by, for example, subject, date, location, things like that. And it makes it possible for other search engines out there to harvest links to our content. So why would we do that? It's better discovery. You don't have to know these are our, quote unquote, our images to find them. Links in our repository are harvested by our library catalog, Google, and the Digital Public Library of America. So what this means for searchers is if I Google mining photographs Gilman, Colorado, we show up somewhere around that first page displayed by Google. So best practices in preservation. This is how we support persistent content over time. Referring specifically to digital content, we use digitization standards that are suitable for our resources and our intent. For images, this includes a TIFF format, so TIFF, and 600 DPI. Our intent is to reproduce a visual experience as close to real life as possible, as if you are holding the photograph in your hand. So we scan true to the original, no cropping and no enhancements. This isn't something everybody does, but this is how we do it. We also keep multiple file copies in different digital locations to make sure that we preserve the digital file, and we use stable migratable data. This supports long-term access. So right now our content is the Mines repository, our digital open repository, and we realize that migrating our digital archives is a given. We will be migrating that data. We're just wrapping up our most recent migration, and we've had, in the time I've been at Mines, we've had at least several migrations from one platform to the next. So we know this is going to happen in the future. So that's why it's important to have stable migratable data. So you've seen images here from these two collections, which focus on mine sites and mining technologies. However, collections of images can have different dimensions and tell other related stories. That's what makes them so fascinating and valuable for historical purposes. For example, just working conditions in a mine site, there are men in a man car, there's a miner at a dump in Lake County, Colorado. There's a miner underground with his mule and a miner working at ore cars, a line of ore cars. And see, these tell us stories about the working conditions. However, stories about people can be told by images that include people related to mining industry. For example, it might be an engineer or someone who works in an office. This is a gentleman farthest left and clockwise on the King lease. There is a man at a furnace in the assay office in the Eldorado mine site, and right down to the staff and the cook in the dining hall at the London Mines and Milling Company. Just, they tell stories about what it was like to be associated with the mining industry. So communities, same thing. On the far left is a picture of the company housing in Gilman, Colorado, built on the hillside. On the top is a Labor Day picnic in Gilman. They found some flat land and they are having a, right now, sack race is depicted here. This is in 1918. Going further down, there's the old post office at Gilman that's been decommissioned. There's a woman and her dog on the streets of Gilman and a picture of the commissary of the London Mines and Milling Company. That while this is a clearly a posed picture, you can see the kinds of things that are available for people on site to buy, right down to something my favorite, the O. Henry candy bars. I think that's what they are. That you can see what resources that they buy. More images that surprised me going through these collections, and I hope that they surprise others. There's a beautiful panorama of Red Cliff, Colorado in the early 1900s, and you can see all the details of the town right down to the chickens in the backyard. Below that to the right is a truly spectacular train derailment, and you can see figures of men standing on top of one of the derailed train cars And finally, the War Chest Gold Ore Car, which was part of a train that was traveling through Colorado. And I'm still looking for the story on that one and exactly what they were talking about when they mean the War Chest Gold Ore. So I want to talk about partnering with archives now. I said this was a partnership, and it absolutely is. We partner with donors in support of accessibility, discovery, and preservation, and donors partner with us by dovetailing some of their own digital image management practices with archival practices for both their benefit and ours. And this is in addition to being donors and donating physical or digital images directly to the archive. We have an Archive Your Stuff page. There's the link. And this page is a guide to archiving your own stuff. Most of this information comes from the Library of Congress, but there are other good websites out there. And it helps to follow archival practice, including digitization standards. This is something that saves time and effort for everybody. So description and metadata, what we use is, and we recommend other people use because it's fairly easy, are a spreadsheet software to record your image file names and descriptions. And it can be Excel, it can be Google Sheets, it doesn't really matter. But it's important to record this information, and good information to have are things like the file name or the photograph name if there's a caption, like as the one depicted here, the creator or who took the pictures, geographic location, date if it's possible, and some sort of title that's descriptive. Narratives add a personal touch if you have additional information. If you are the photographer, or if you have some information from someone or some other resource about a particular photograph, it's a good idea to record that information. This is context. This is something that if you just handed me a box of photos, I wouldn't know some of this information unless you included it. And it's good to have in general, okay? excuse me. And just to give you an idea, impact for us to take a physical photo to a web accessible image is an estimated 5 to 10 minutes per image and 3 to 4 people at our site to do so. And so anything that gives us a leg up in making this information accessible is great. You are not an archive, we know that. But if you've already taken some of these steps to improve your own image management, these same steps can facilitate our workflow too to make your donated images accessible. And I will say, as someone who continuously struggles with managing their own personal images, I can definitely relate to having 2 boxes full of photographs that have not been described and have not been recorded. So every little bit that people can do is helpful. So the benefits of partnering with an archive are in terms of resources. Even small archives often have digital resources. They might have a repository or a website that they can use. And if nothing else, we can exchange expertise and knowledge. Meeting with an archivist, ask questions and get referrals. I do the same thing. And we can share knowledge in aid of preserving these images. The shared discovery, as I mentioned, openly accessible web platforms can reach a world audience because other people should see the stuff that you have. Okay. I also value the connectivity of web collections, so digital collections on the web. When I talked about Googling mining photographs, Gilman, Colorado, I also discover a Library of Congress collection, several social image sites, and 3 museum and library sites related to Gilman, Colorado. Sharing discovery identifies connections that are richer than any single archive or individual could provide, no matter how big or small. So the long haul. We're all partners in preserving these mining images. However we decide to participate and at whatever level we are able to participate, we are all partners in keeping the history of mining accessible and alive. So that's the end of my presentation. My email address is here, as is the address for the Mines Repository where our photos reside. And I would like to thank you for watching this presentation.